Chapter 12 of Danger in Deep Space. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Danger in Deep Space by Carey ROCKWELL. Narrated by Sam Holloway. Chapter 12.
How much longer before we reach the atmosphere of Terra, Manning?
Asked Loring. Roger bent over the chart table and quickly measured the distance between his present position and that of Tara.
About 2 hours,
he said, straightening up.
Good,
said Loring.
Let me know as soon as we get close.
Okay,
replied the cadet.
Hey, radar deck.
Mason's voice came over the intercom from the power deck of the Space Devil.
Don't forget to let me know when I have to cut down on thrust.
Take it easy, space boy,
snapped Roger.
You'll know in plenty of time.
He turned back to the radar scanner and continued the never-ending sweep of space ahead. After a week of checking and reconditioning the Space Devil in the wild Venusian jungles, Roger had become more and more disgusted with himself. Being a wanted spaceman had had his disadvantages on Spaceman's Row, but working in the steaming jungles, fighting deadly reptiles and insects with Loring and Mason on his neck every minute, had soured his appetite for adventure. Several times, when Roger had suggested a certain part be replaced, Loring and he had argued violently, and Roger had threatened to quit. Now, after the long, tedious trip through space, Roger's relationship with the others was more strained than ever. The sure dependability of Tom on the control deck and Astro on the power deck made the work of Loring and Mason sloppy by comparison. Once, when Roger had been on radar watch, while the ship roared through the asteroid belt, collision with a small asteroid had threatened. Roger ordered a course change, but Mason, who had taken over the power deck, had been asleep. Luckily, Shinny had been nearby, had made the course change and saved the ship. Seething with anger, Roger had gone to the power deck and given the shiftless spaceman a terrific beating. Over and over, conflicts had arisen among them as they blasted through deep space, and always, it seemed to Roger, he was in the middle of it. The only satisfaction he could find in the hazardous venture was the prospect of the 5 million credits, and even this had lost its excitement in the last few days, as his nerves stretched to the breaking point. Only the sly humour of Shinny had saved Roger from the monotony of the long haul through space. Roger absently flipped the scanner to its farthest range. He'd been observing the planet Tara for several hours and knew its shape fairly well. But he suddenly jerked to attention. His hands trembled slightly as he peered intently at the scope. Finally, he slumped back. There was no doubt about it. On the scanner was a jet boat in flight.
Hey, Loring, Shinny, Mason, get up here on the double,
he yelled into the intercom.
What's up?
Demanded Loring.
Get up here,
shouted Roger.
We're in for trouble. Plenty of trouble.
Presently, the three spacemen were grouped around the scanner, staring at the unmistakable outline of a jet boat.
By the rings of Saturn,
declared Loring.
It must be Connel and his crew.
What are we going to do?
Whined Mason. Loring's face darkened.
Only one thing we can do now,
he growled.
What do you mean?
Asked Roger.
I mean that we're going to blast them,
Loring snarled.
Connel and whoever else is with him.
But...
stammered Roger.
The Polaris crew is down there.
Listen, Manning.
Loring turned to the cadet.
Have you forgotten that you're wanted by the Solar Guard? You give that bunch down there a chance and they'll make you a space crawler on Prison Rock.
Why, I...
stammered Roger. He knew what Loring had said was the truth. If it was Connel, there would be no question what would happen to him. He faced Loring.
What will you do to them?
One well-placed reactant bomb and they'll never know a thing,
sneered Loring.
But you don't have any bombs aboard,
said Roger.
A little of the fuel, and I can build one easily enough,
replied Loring. He turned to Mason.
Go below and suit up to go into the reaction chamber,
he ordered.
Get an extra lead suit out. I'll go in and help you. And find something we can use for a trigger and a fuse.
He smiled at Roger.
It might be a little crude, but it'll be fancy enough for what we want. I'm going to blast the Polaris from here back to your sweet little space academy.
Mason and Loring left the radar bridge while Shinny and Roger watched the white blip of the jet boat.
That could be Tom and Astro in that jet boat,
said Roger softly to himself.
I guess I'd better stand by the power deck while we manoeuvre,
said Shinny.
We want to stay hidden until Loring and Mason get that thing ready.
Roger nodded and Shinny disappeared. Manoeuvring cautiously, Roger brought the space devil around to the night side of Tara, opposite to the landing site of the Polaris. 4 hours later, Loring and Mason came out of the reactant chamber carrying a small lead box. They placed it gently on the deck and began taking off their lead suits. Roger and Shinny stared at the box.
"There she is,"
said Loring.
"Not much to look at, but there's enough juice in there to blast the Polaris into space junk."
"Wait a minute, Loring,"
said Roger.
"There'll be no killing. No one gets hurt."
"Got a squeamish stomach, eh, kid?"
Loring laughed. He slapped Mason on the back.
"Our little space cadet is suddenly worrying about his friends. The same friends that wanted to send him away to the prison asteroid."
"Blast the ship if you want,"
said Roger coldly.
"But don't hurt the crew."
"Listen, Manning,"
snarled Loring.
"If the crew gets hurt, it ain't my fault. If they're in the ship, that's tough. If not, then that's okay with me. I ain't sending them any letter telling them I'm going to blast their ship and then have them come up after me with a space torpedo."
Roger didn't answer. He turned away and climbed back to the radar bridge. Loring followed him up the ladder.
"Don't get any ideas about warning your buddies, Manning, because if you do, I'll blast you before I blast them."
"Don't worry,"
replied Roger.
"It's daytime on the other side of Tara now, where the Polaris is. The crew might be out on a scouting mission or making observations away from the ship. There's less chance of their being on the ship. If we're going to do it, let's get it over with."
"Okay with me,"
said Loring.
"Take this wagon up towards Alpha Centauri, a little way. Coming out of the sun, they won't see us. We'll use one of the jet boats to deliver our little present. I'll set the fuse, put the jet boat on automatic, and aim it right for the Polaris."
"All right,"
agreed Manning reluctantly. He turned to the chart table, plotted a course, and issued orders to Shinny at the controls and to Mason on the power deck. Soon the Space Devil was blasting away from the night side of the planet, heading toward the sun. When they reached an altitude of 1,000 miles above the surface of the planet, Loring manoeuvred the jet boat into position outside the ship and placed the crewed reactant bomb inside. Ready, he gave Roger the signal to make the run out of the sun toward the Polaris. Roger relayed the orders to Shinny and Mason, and the Space Devil rocketed back toward the planet again. Loring, sitting inside the jet boat, waited until they had reached an altitude of 500 miles.
"All right, Manning,"
said Loring.
"Give me the course."
Roger calculated the rotational speed of the planet, the Space Devil's altitude, and the speed of the jet boat. He drew a line between the Space Devil and the Polaris, checked it on the astro compass, and reached for the intercom mic. He ran a dry tongue over his lips and called out the course.
"Course is 143.
He caught himself and stared at the chart. Suppose Tom or Astro or anyone was near the ship. Even if he missed by several hundred yards, the bomb would certainly be fatal. If he only changed the course 1 degree at a range of 500 miles, it would miss the Polaris by several miles. And Loring wouldn't be able to see anything because of the dust cloud."
"Course corrected,"
said Roger.
"New course is 142.
142.
Repeated Loring. Roger sat back and waited for the small spacecraft to blast off from the ship. In his mind, he saw Loring setting the trigger on the bomb, adjusting the controls, setting the automatic pilot, and then pressing the acceleration button. Roger gripped the sides of the chart table and stared at the radar scanner. A fast-moving blip was streaking across its surface. Loring had started the jet boat. His eyes showing his great fear, Roger watched the blip as it sped down like a maddened hornet toward the Polaris, resting on its directional fins in the green jungle. He could hear the hatch slam close below as Loring re-entered the ship. But he continued to watch the rapidly moving blip. Suddenly, it disappeared, and Roger knew it had reached Tara. He slumped back in his chair. His eyes were glassy, his ears deaf to the roar of triumph from below as Loring and Mason, watching the flight of the jet boat on the control deck teleceiver screen, saw it explode. Roger couldn't move. He had fired a reactant bomb at Tom and Astro.
"By the craters of Luna!"
roared Connel.
"We've been attacked!"
The four Earthmen, exploring a valley several miles north of the Polaris, had been thrown to the ground when the bomb landed. Connell's reaction was immediate and decisive.
"Get into the jet boat, all of you! We've got to get back to the Polaris! If our ship is smashed, we'll spend the rest of our lives fighting this jungle!"
In a matter of seconds, the four spacemen were rocketing over the jungle toward the Polaris. Presently, they came to an enormous dust cloud that had mushroomed out over the trees. It was so thick, Tom found it difficult to pilot the small craft.
"Any danger of radioactivity in this dust, sir?"
asked Astro.
Always that possibility, Astro,
answered Connel.
We'll know soon enough.
He flipped on a built-in Geiger counter on the dashboard of the jet boat, and immediately the cabin was filled with a loud ticking that warned of danger.
The counter's up 750, sir,
said Astro.
Not enough to bother you unless you're in it a long time.
There's the Polaris, sir,
yelled Tom.
She's still on her directional fins. They've missed her. She's okay.
By the blessed rings of Saturn, she is,
exclaimed Connel.
Go on, Tom. Give this baby the gun. If we have to die, let's die like spacemen. In space, fighting with spacemen's weapons. Not crawling around here in the jungle like worms.
The three boys smiled at their skipper's rousing statement.
This is the time,
thought Tom,
when I'd rather have Major Connel in command than anyone else in the Solar Guard.
If there was to be a fight, then they'd certainly found the man who knew how to do just that, fight. Tom swooped over the treetops recklessly, and fearing the blast had damaged the jet boat airlock, brought the small craft to rest in the blinding dust a few yards away from the Polaris. 3 minutes later, the four spacemen had separated and were standing by their respective posts. Hasty but thorough checks were made to determine the damage, and finding none, they prepared to raise ship.
All clear, forward and up,
Alfie reported in a high, squeaking voice.
Energise the cooling pumps,
shouted Tom. Astro had already started the mighty pumps, their vibrations rocking the ship, and Tom began counting the seconds.
A standby to raise ship, minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Paying scant attention to the crush of the sudden acceleration, Tom gave the ship all the power she could take for the climb out of Tara's atmosphere, and soon they were rocketing through the airless void of space. Alfie and Connel hurriedly swept the area with the radar scanner for the attacking intruder.
There she is!
Roared Connel.
There!
He placed a finger on a white blip on the scanner.
By the craters of Luna! That's an Earth ship!
The fear of an outer space invasion by hostile people from another world had been in the back of his mind, but he'd been reluctant to voice his fears in front of the cadets.
And she's an old one at that,
he exclaimed.
Not even armed. I know that class vessel. Corbett,
he shouted.
Aye, aye, sir,
replied Tom.
Put the ship on automatic flight. Attack approach pattern number 3. Then stand by to send a message to whoever's manning that ship.
Aye, aye, sir,
replied Tom. He hurriedly set the delicate device that would fly the ship in a pre-planned course of zigzag manoeuvres and opened the circuits of the teleceivers.
All set for the message, sir,
reported Tom.
Tell them,
said Connel heavily, his voice cold.
Whoever they are, that I'll give them 2 minutes to surrender. If they don't, I'll blast them into protons.
Very well, sir,
said Tom. He turned to the teleceiver and began twirling the dials.
Attention! Attention! Rocket cruiser Polaris to spaceship X. Polaris to spaceship X. You are ordered to surrender within 2 minutes or we will attack. By order of Major Connel, Senior Line Officer, Solar Guard.
He switched the teleceiver for reception and waited. In a moment, the screen blurred and then an image appeared. Tom gasped. It was Roger.
Tom, Tom!
Yelled Roger.
Tom, this is me, Roger.
Roger! What are you doing out here? How'd you get here?
I can't explain now,
said Roger.
I...
Tom interrupted him.
Roger, you've been cleared. The investigation of the crash on the station proved that Loring and Mason are guilty. They're wanted for the crash and the deaths of Jardine and Bangs.
What? You mean...
stammered Roger.
Yes, Loring and Mason did the whole thing,
supplied Tom.
Look, Tom,
pleaded Roger.
Give me 10 minutes. Don't fire for 10 minutes. I'm going to try an idea. If I'm not successful, then open up and blast us back to Mars.
Roger, wait!
Shouted Tom.
What's going on? What are you doing on that ship?
I can't talk now,
answered Roger.
Loring and Mason are on the ship with me. Remember, 10 minutes, and if I don't contact you, then open fire.
End of chapter 12.